Zkusím to zahrát, svoje zoufalství. Tak jako v černošských básních, jen několika tóny, mé nástroje. A stvořit hudbu, samec svírající hrdlo. Jak Langston Hughes, jak měsíc, stoupající nad harlemské střechy, nad spící klikatinu nocí bez útěchy, nad střechy Dornichu.
Thank you, Alžběta. And everybody, welcome to our discussion, Ivan Blatný, Langston Hughes, Transnationality, Translation, and the Blues. What we have just heard was an excerpt from Blatný's 1945 collection, Tento večer, this evening. And in this collection, he's heavily inspired and influenced by the poetry of Langston Hughes, especially his first collection, The Weary Blues. Paradoxically enough, for somebody who spent most of his, especially later life, between Czech and English, Blatný would have read these poems in translation, as he did not read in English, as he did not speak the language just yet. This is one of the connections that we will explore today in our talk, in our discussion about intertextuality, the issues of translation, and the wider context of an exchange between Czech, Czechoslovak, and African-American literary communities. And I'm so pleased to be able to welcome our guests here. And I think, like, I'm just so excited because there is no better, I can't really imagine better people to have this discussion with. First, Julie Hansen from Uppsala University, where she is a professor of Slavic languages and the Department of Modern Languages. Charles Sabatos, a professor of English and comparative literature at Yeditepe University. And then in the middle, Justin Quinn, a poet who teaches at Charles University and the University of West Bohemia in Plzeň. And I've only talked about their academic titles. To list their achievement would take too long, but I also wanted to point out that they're all also translators of Czech and Slovak literature. My name is Františka Šormová. I am a postdoc here at the Institute of Czech Literature, and I also teach at the University of Hradec Králové, and I do not translate any Czech or Slovak literature. Apologies. And again, I'm also excited to welcome you all here. It's so nice to see people from translation studies, comparative literature studies, to see translators who all translate Czech and Slovak literature. Welcome. So we will do this in this way. We'll have a little introductory round where everybody talks a bit about their relation to Blatný Hughes, the topic, the research. Then I will ask some questions, and then hopefully you'll also ask some questions. So Julie, if I can hand it to you.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me well? Thank you for the introduction and the invitation to participate in this very interesting seminar. I'm really looking forward to our discussion today. So let me start with a little background about how I came to study the poetry of Ivan Blatný. It was his connection to a place, Brno, that first led me to read his work. As a graduate student at the University of Michigan, and I'm American, although I live in Sweden now, and actually, my route to Sweden went through Brno, but that's another story. But as a graduate student at the University of Michigan in Ann Arbor, and one of my professors from there is here today, Jindřich Toman, I took Czech language classes, and our teacher was from Brno, Zdenka Brodská. She had emigrated after 68. And after attending the Letní škola češtiny here in Prague in the summer of 93, that was my first time in the Czech Republic, at the end of that summer, I took the bus to Brno because I was curious to see this city that I had first encountered in Kundera stories. We read as a language learning exercise two stories from Snezhne Lasky. And although the focus was on reading comprehension, Pani Brodska's comments along the way on the cultural and sociological background and details in the stories evoked for me the particular time and place in which they were set. And this made me want to go to Brno, which I did, and which I immediately took a liking to. And I decided the next time I came to the Czech Republic to study Czech, I would go to Brno, mostly because so many people in Prague wanted to speak English with me. It was easier to immerse myself in Czech in Brno at the time. So I did go back to Brno a year later and ended up spending another year there as a Fulbright researcher. And it was at that time that I began reading Ivan Blatný's work with the guidance of very good teachers. And this led me, sort of as a side project to my dissertation, which was on Russian symbolism, to write two articles on Blatný's poetry. One focusing on intertextuality in the poem Basen v cizím bytě, intertextuality with the Weary Blues by Langston Hughes, but also other writers. And the other was on multilingual elements in Blatný's later collections, Staré bydliště and Pomocná škola Bixley. That said, I have to emphasize that my work on Blatný is quite limited. I've gone on to do other things, and I don't normally teach Czech literature, not for lack of interest, but lack of opportunity. Czech isn't taught at my university, but I do use Czech literary works as examples in survey courses when I have a chance. So when I pick up Blatný, it's for pure pleasure reading. But in preparation for this seminar, I went back to the two articles I wrote 20 years ago now. And that was interesting because I saw that, in a way, for me, that was the beginning of research interests that have continued ever since. The theme of memory, intertextuality, and especially literary multilingualism. Translation studies is also an area in which I work. So I returned now to the poems that I analyzed decades ago with new eyes, because it was really Blatný's work that first opened my eyes to multilingual poetics, the way that he mixed languages. And since then, I've acquired and also partly developed for myself more of a theoretical framework for understanding multilingual writing. So although there was nothing in my articles I felt the need to correct or revise, I realized that if I were to go back and study these same texts today, I would do it somewhat differently. It would be a question of focus. Because I, in my article on multilingual poetics, described Blatný's emigration as a break with his Czech period, which I viewed as monolingual poetics in contrast to what Blatney did later. Today, I would tend to look for continuity, actually, and see the multilingualism in Blatney's work as a development of his poetics that were present in various ways from the very beginning. I would also be interested in returning to the question of intertextuality in Blatney's work in a broader way, looking at networks of influences and milieu, and not focusing, as I did in the articles, on specific textual instances and also evidence from, well, archival evidence of influence and intertextuality. And this is something that others here have looked at, the way that literature and styles traveled over the iron or through the Iron Curtain, or in despite the Cold War. It's very interesting to look at those examples today. And then the third thing I might approach differently is that I would look more closely at the role of translation in Blatney's work, and view it as, again, not as a side or a secondary activity for Blatney, but view it as part of the whole and see what such a perspective might reveal. Okay, I'll stop there.
Okay. Thanks.
Hi. So I'm here for perhaps two reasons. A few years ago, I published a book which was about the way that poetry travels back and forth across the Iron Curtain between the Czech literary environment and the Anglophone literary environment. And I was interested in, you know, like Julie's phrase, we have common interests in that, you know, she's saying that, you know, how the work traveled despite the Iron Curtain. But I might have done it because of the Iron Curtain. You know, how did these works travel? How did the Cold War and how did the Iron Curtain actually enable literary exchanges and actually intensify them in for me was surprising ways which I hadn't counted on. I found all kind of bizarre pathways between the two literary traditions. For instance, I concentrated a good deal on the very strange positions of the Czech poet Miroslav Holub, both in the Czech Republic and in the Anglophone world, which it's like night and day. I began the book by asking, like, how come? What's going on? And this became like a thread that I just kept pulling at and pulling at. And it revealed to me a bizarre set of networks that were really much broader, a bizarre set of, like, aesthetic influences that traveled back and forth across the Iron Curtain, but also strange twists of ideology as well, especially, I suppose, ultimately, the way these affected Anglophone poetry. So, like, I came to it as a critic of Anglophone poetry primarily. I'm not a scholar of Czech literature. I'm kind of a real amateur, and I feel I'm on very thin ice there. So I wanted to know, you know, what this could tell us, what Czech poetry could tell us about Anglophone literature. The book ended up with a reconsideration of major Anglophone poets such as Seamus Heaney, Derek Walcott, and the kind of in-between one of Joseph Brodsky. That is perhaps one of the reasons why I'm here. The The book, as far as I remember, doesn't mention Ivan Blatny once. I mean, there might have been just like a brief aside, but and you would think that that he would be a perfect example for this, you know, because he did like physically travel across the Iron Curtain. In poems, he traveled back and forth, especially in his later poems, between the two languages and sometimes other languages as well, mainly German. But he wasn't a part of that. So I come to Blatny from a different point of view, not so much as an academic, but primarily as a translator of poetry, and also as kind of surprised me on one occasion, as a poet. And I'll explain that. When a few years ago they were putting together an English language selection of his work, Veronika Tokareva, it's right here, The Drug of Art, Ivan Blatny, she asked me to do some of the poems, and I immediately wanted to do the poems from the collection I refer to as Brněnské elegie. And I have difficulty referring to it by its actual published title of Melancholické procházky. I consider it one of the worst titles that was ever formulated in Czech poetry. And I believe the reason for the shift away from Brněnské elegie was something to do with wartime censorship. I feel very strongly that that's the correct name for the book, because it puts the book strongly in line, as has been pointed out, with Rilke, but also Goethe, and in a central European tradition, poetic tradition, where, you know, Brno takes its really rightful place, where he writes the poetics of the city. And so I translated those poems mainly, and some of the later macaronic poems. I was attracted to them because they were in marvelous lines of Alexandrine, you know, the hexameter line, which is it's really difficult to translate into English because it has six feet in it, and it's like kind of trying to wrestle with a python. It just gets out of hand so easily. Pentameter, that's what is, I thought, was the way to translate Blatny into English, because that's a standard line in Anglophone poetry. So I was deeply attracted by those poems, and I really had very little time for the ones that came immediately afterwards. I think Františka has the actual book there, the Tento Večer, which was strongly influenced by Langston Hughes, but not just Langston Hughes, but also the other poets who were influencing Group 42 at that time, especially T.S. Eliot as well. It seems to me like a very strong mixture of T.S. Eliot and Langston Hughes in those books, and other influences, especially from Francophone poetry. What I saw then in the later poems was a kind of the weird macaronic poems of Bixley and Stará Bydliště, which were, I had never seen anything like them before. The way that they switch between languages, they have such an intense nostalgia for Brno, and particular places in Brno, football clubs before the Second World War, the rivers, the Svratka is there, and for Blatny in a mental asylum in England in this period, these places and people kind of seemed to have more reality for him than the world around him, immediately around him. But I first came to Blatny actually through an English poet in the early 90s. There was a book of poems published called Cigarettes for Mr. Blatny. And it was by a poet called, I think he's not publishing anymore, Nick Drake. And this is not to be, he's not to be mixed up with the songwriter and singer Nick Drake, who died a good bit before that. And Blatny appeared as a figure in this book, as an old Czech man in asylum, and there were several poems for him. I don't know exactly what contact the poet had with Blatney. But that tweaked my interest, and then I came here and I saw this big book on the shelves of the bookshelf, and I bought it, and then couldn't read it for 10 years and kept looking at it, and then went further. And I also came to Blatney as a poet. I found myself in Brno for a few weeks some years ago, and I would go to one particular cafe, which Blatney did not go to. It did not exist when he lived. It was not on Obilný trh, where Blatney, you know, had the family apartment, but it was a kind of post-industrial hipster place, Skoog urban hub, if any of you know it, on Dominikanske námestí. And I found myself writing a poem that was a conversation with Ivan Blatney, as though he had come, it was springtime, and he had come to check out the city and have a bit of a colloquy, which it was marvelous to kind of engage with them on this other level as well, like academic, like not academically, but as a translator at one stage, but also as a kind of resident ghost in Brno, who I feel is very much still around walking the streets of the city. So that's me.
Thanks. Okay, so my connection to this topic also goes back to the mid to late 1990s, like with Julie and I think with Justin, from what I gathered. My background's in comparative literature, and I have always had Czech and Slovak, and kind of in the center of that, but really looking at ways that they go beyond linguistic borders and have these connections with other literatures. And in comparative literature, there's a bit of a gap in terms of Central European and Slavic studies. There's not that much attention paid to that. It's almost like, well, there's other fields that work on that. So I've always looked at connections that might not be as well explored or documented. And one thing I think that I've been working against a little bit from the very beginning is this kind of idea that if we look at these so-called smaller literatures, that you can compare them with the great literatures. So Czech literature, we can compare it to French or German, possibly, you know, Russian and English. But going more laterally with other sort of smaller minority literatures in different places, it seems to be a little bit more unexpected. And in the case of this particular topic, I was first taking a course on African American literature that had a large section on the Harlem Renaissance. And Langston Hughes is a writer that I have been interested in for a long time, and I've taught him quite a bit as well. But when I was taking this course as a graduate student, reading this very important collection, very diverse collection of articles in called The New Negro, which was kind of a manifesto for African-American writing in the 1920s, edited by the scholar Elaine Locke. And I just ran across an unexpected reference to Prague that, again, coming from this idea that, you know, what would writers in Harlem really be thinking about Prague or about Central Europe in general. It came sort of out of the blue. And then I started to run across further, very passing references, and it's almost like you blink and you miss them, but yet when you put them together, they form this interesting network where these writers are actually, and it's not comparative in this sort of speculative sense, like here are these two smaller literatures going through differing forms of oppression. These are actual ways that African-American writers were referring to Prague and Czechoslovakia, even in these very kind of passing cases. So I was just gonna give the concrete examples that I ran across, the first of which comes from this work called The New Negro Interpretation. And when you read the introduction, here is one of the leading African-American intellectuals of the 1920s, and he put together a collection of works that were, I mean, essays, fiction, poetry, meant to represent the best of Black writing at the time, but also with a bit of an implicit political statement for, you know, more respect for African-American writing. And he has two references in separate parts of his introduction and his sort of framing material. And so he uses the term the new Negro. It's sort of this more culturally confident after World War I and Harlem becoming a cultural center for obviously a lot of different socially and culturally important people in the African-American community. But the quote that I first saw was actually the one at the bottom here. Without pretense to their political significance, Harlem has the same role to play for the new Negro as Dublin has for the new Ireland, or Prague for the new Czechoslovakia. Okay, so again, writing this in 1925, only a few years after both Irish independence and Czechoslovak independence. And when we think of sort of in maybe post-colonial terms or Anglophone literature, that the Irish comparison might seem a little more, it might fit into categories that we might be familiar with, but comparing Harlem to 1920s Prague just seemed really odd, and why he would be making that. And when, in addition to that, there was another quote where he was comparing it even more broadly. Again, this idea of the new Negro, which Harlem was the center, but Langston Hughes was one of the leading figures of this as well, which is where that comes in. And so again, these are both Elaine Locke. We're now presenting the new Negro in a national and even international scope, as in India, in China, in Egypt, Ireland, Russia, Bohemia, Palestine, and Mexico, we're witnessing the resurgence of a people. And this also shows an interesting, a little like linguistic slippage, that in English until 1918, Bohemia and Bohemian were much more widely used than Czech. Really, Czech became used more widely after Czechoslovakia was established as a country. So he's still, within the same text, he's using sort of the newer term and also going back to Bohemia. But why does Elaine Locke refer to Czechoslovakia in a text about the new Negro? And the reason that I pieced together was that his collection, which came out as a book entitled The New Negro Interpretation, it was based on an issue of the journal Survey Graphic, which was a kind of a sociological journal, and an issue that they had put together called Harlem, Mecca of the New Negro, and that's on the right here. That's the journal issue, which later became not identical, but it was the basis of his collection, The New Negro, and some of the pieces he added, took out, but more or less, that was the starting point. And when he originally wrote that introduction, it was as an introduction to this journal issue, not to his separate collection. And the Survey Graphic had been doing sort of national issues on different cultures around the world. And they had an issue on Russia, one on Ireland, and there was one on Czechoslovakia. It was called Prague, the American Spirit in the Heart of Europe. And that was 4 years earlier, 1921. The Survey Graphic had this issue, which is on the left-hand side. And it had interviews with various people and really showing that you know, this new Czechoslovak Republic, which of course had all these American connections and Masaryk being in the U.S. during the, you know, just before the foundation of the Republic. So there was it really shows how they were presenting Czechoslovakia in the 1920s, and how obviously that image that Czechoslovakia had for an American reader, it was very different from, you know, what has come to us now. We still think in this sort of post-socialist context, and Czechoslovakia being, you know, within this Eastern Bloc type of mentality most Americans still have. But in the 1920s, that wasn't the case. Czechoslovakia was really seen as the American spirit in the heart of Europe, and therefore Locke alludes to it. Well, the new Negroes in Harlem also deserve to be seen as, you know, truly American, but also culturally unique. So, so coming to Langston Hughes, Hughes had grown up in the Midwest, and he went to high school in Cleveland, which was a center of a lot of Slavic immigrant groups, Slovaks, Polish, and some Czechs as well. But his best friend in high school was Polish. And so from his autobiography, which he published in, well, the first of his two autobiographies, The Big C, he was looking back at his Slavic classmates. So there's this other side, which is not just looking at Czechoslovakia as this republic on this American model, but also the contribution that immigrants had made to establishing that republic, right? The support of Czech and Slovak immigrants when Czechoslovakia was breaking free from the Habsburg Empire. And there's an interesting quote here that Hughes says, when I was in high school, it was a very nearly entirely a foreign-born school with a few native, white, and colored American students mixed in. By foreign, I mean children of foreign-born parents. And this is interesting because even Langston Hughes, who is so sensitive to this feeling of outsiderness and marginalization, he sees these children of immigrants, not even immigrants themselves, as being foreign, as being somehow less American. So there's this interesting underlying sense here, and the fact that within these families, they had access to sort of different political discourse going on, whether they came from Russia or Poland, about the Russian Revolution and things that were not available to sort of the mainstream middle-class American students of his time, let's say. Okay, so the interesting quote that I ran across with Hughes, there's a couple of other quotes that are also related to Czechoslovakia, but this is probably the most puzzling, perhaps, is from his story, Luania of the Jungles, which was published in 1928. And it's a bit like a Heart of Darkness type story, which that of course has this Polish subtext with Conrad, but there's a somewhat autobiographical narrator who is traveling up the Niger River and meets a strange, weak looking little white man with a queer accent who has a vague far off air about him. Okay, so he's traveling in Africa, which Hughes did travel to Africa, to West Africa in the 1920s, and I think several other times. So he has this conversation with this man, and the only thing we know about this man is that he's come from Paris. And this is, you know, still colonial Africa. And so he says, good evening to the man. The man says, bonsoir. And he says, ah, vous êtes français, I ask. Non, he replied. So it's this odd, it's even shifting back and forth between languages. He says, I'm not French, but I lived in Paris for a long while, right? And then he says, I'm a poet, but I destroy my poems. So here's this man who's peculiar for various reasons, his accent, his nationality, you know, why does he write poems and then destroy them? And then we learn that he actually had fallen in love with an African woman, the Luani of the title, who went back to Africa, and he follows her, he wants to somehow get her back. And it is very passing references. I dropped my courses at the Sorbonne that week and wrote my father in Prague that I would be going on a journey south for my health's sake. Okay, so again, there's no real reason for this character to be from Prague. He just drops it in there. He never explains why he's from Prague. And actually, this also, there's a kind of, because it's such a passing reference, various critics who've discussed this story, they tend to even overlook that and discuss him as a French character. But I think it's interesting that he somehow added this extra detail that he's not French, but Czech, or from Prague. Okay, so that's again something that, again, the same time period, the Harlem Renaissance era. And then in the 1930s and 1940s, Hughes got more politically engaged. And that was when he got much more involved in. He traveled to the Soviet Union. He was part of this group of African-American, not even professional filmmakers, but they were invited to supposedly make a film that never, you know, came together. But he traveled extensively through the Soviet Union and Central Asia and wrote a lot of interesting stuff. There's been some scholarship on his writings about traveling to the Turkic republics and how especially women had been liberated in those, and really seeing the Soviet Union in very positive terms, obviously free of racial discrimination that he was used to. And coming back to the 30s and 40s, he has this ambiguous sympathy with Czechoslovakia, first in 1938 and then during the war. So right after, around the time of the Munich Agreement and Czechoslovakia, this American spirit in the heart of Europe that's been sacrificed to Nazi Germany, he has this really shocking image, Czechoslovakia lynched on a swastika cross. So putting the swastika and lynching together, it's just blow, bitter winds blow. So this crucified Czechoslovakia, but he ties it to lynching, which was this, you know, plague, social plague in the, especially American South. And another poem that he wrote sometime in the 40s was a message to the president, to Roosevelt, and how they're liberating the, you know, they're going to liberate Europe from the Germans. I hear you talking about freedom for the Finn, the Jew, and the Czechoslovak, but you never seem to mention us folks who are black. And when you mention the Finns and the Jew and the Czechoslovak, don't forget the 14 million here who are black. So if there's so much sympathy for these oppressed Europeans where there's all this oppression going on at home. So again, it's this might seem a little bit more of a logical connection because, you know, Lidice and all these things that would have been in the consciousness, but it also ties into other things he'd written about Czechoslovakian Slavic immigrants. And the last quote that or two little quotes from articles that he wrote, because he wrote a lot of essays as well. Again, this idea, an ambiguity about liberating Czechoslovakia and not paying attention to social conditions at home. An article he wrote called If Dixie Invades Europe from 1943, so before D-Day and everything with the American liberation. Berlin, Prague, and Copenhagen were all nice cities, racially speaking, before the spread of the fascist powers and the coming of war. When we liberate those once charming cities, it would be a shame for our armies to promulgate there our own fascist-like racial policies toward colored people. And then after the war, again, right after February 48 and sort of this consolidation of Soviet power in Eastern Europe, he's responding to what would have been in the press about these nations being suppressed under the Soviet domination. He says, of course, the thing that puzzles us colored folks about our white folks is that all the things they now accuse Russia of doing, our white folks themselves have been doing to us for years. They accuse Russia of denying a free ballot to Poland, Hungary, the Russian folks themselves, and now Prague. But again, sort of pointing out the hypocrisy of this shock and dismay about the rise of, you know, the spread of communism westward to Central Europe. And so this connection then that we've already touched on here to finish up is that of course during the war, when Hughes was writing these things, Blatny was himself writing poetry that was inspired by Hughes. So in my article that for years I was sort of collecting these little tidbits, and I didn't really have exactly the right way to put them together. And finally, when I ran across Julie's article on Blatny writing about Hughes, that was the sort of keystone that I needed, that gave me the other side, that finally not just the writers from Harlem, including Hughes, writing about the Czechs, but then Czechs writing back to Harlem. And this has appeared in the biographical novel by Martin Reiner Basnik, and who notes that Blatny was inspired and influenced by Hughes in Tento Večer that you pointed out there. And there's a quote here about the way that he really was turning towards a more individual style through imitating Hughes and then developing that further. So that's really to come full circle back to Blatny.
Speaking of full circles, I'm glad that we not only have this transnational topic, but we can also see how the scholarship itself kind of moves in these various, we have these various journeys, either, you know, Slavic studies, kind of looking at Czech literature, or, you know, Justin coming to Prague, discovering Czech literature for himself. Did not need it to be discovered, but, you know, not a Columbus story, but anyway, full circles. And I wanted just to point out that Charles Sabatis was actually here at the Bohemistické Stipendium at this institution a while ago, so it's great to welcome you here again. Where was your office, Charles? Was it? You have one?
I did most of my work in the library, so I was just across the courtyard most of the time.
Okay, so it might be nice to know you can't really see the library from where we are sitting, but it's nice. I will steal a couple of minutes for myself and kind of follow up on what Charles has said. I have written a bit on connections between Blatny in Hughes, but when I was going through it, I realized I can't really speak. I have to moderate, because if I were to speak about that, I would only quote Julian Charles. So, I mean, that's the awkward moment when you actually sit in a room with people that you quote. So, yeah. But I wanted to talk a bit about, and actually give you a handout, just to give you these crumbs from these like little snippets from archival research that I did on Hughes' Czechoslovak connections. And those are from the 1950s and 1960s. And I will basically just give you the moral lesson right away. And I pointed out a couple of interesting things. There were a lot of invitations. For example, the invitation to the film festival in Karlovy Vary. Unfortunately, Hughes did not come, but I just find it hilarious that it would be like this like long line of guests, starting with, you know, Langston Hughes, one of the first years, and then Johnny Depp, and I don't know who else. So sadly, that did not happen, but he was also invited to a lot of premieres of his works, of his plays in Czechoslovakia, etc. Then I used a few excerpts from his correspondence with Kamil Bednář that he calls Karel Bednář for some reason, but I mean, we'll just let this one slip. And then his correspondence with Jiří Valia. And I think it's just, especially the correspondence with Valia, is fascinating in the way that Valia Valia actually writes to Hughes and asks about various words that he did not understand, and it's so interesting to see what would be understandable for Valia in 1950s, 1960s Czechoslovakia, and what sort of kind of negotiations about meanings the two of them would have, and how would that actually then be embodied in how would then Valia actually translate Hughes. But what I wanted to point out here especially was that these connections and these sort of exchanges are not a one-way street, or not even a two-way street. And what I mean by this is it's not just Czech poets and translators and cultural mediators that would reach out to Hughes, but it's also Hughes that writes, for example, to Karel Bednář, and you know, he writes to him and says, I have heard from Eva Hesse, who was a German translator of Hughes, that you have translated Robinson Jeffers, and I'm so glad that you are doing that. Thank you for this. So you have people reaching out from both sides, and this is happening at the early 1960s and even in the late 1950s, the period where we typically don't see a lot of, you know, we don't think of as a period when a lot of dialogue would be happening across the Iron Curtain. So not a one-way street and not even a two-way street, because a lot of the correspondence with both Bednář and Valia would be around poets from different African countries, be it Mozambique or Angola, when they're giving each other recommendations for poets that have either translated or they are about to translate, and asking each other, do you know this poet? Do you know that poet? And I think this adds another layer of these exchanges, that it's not just between African American and Czechoslovak culture, but you also need to draw in all of these other stories or all of these other cultures, especially at that time where the decolonization processes are happening. So these are the parts that I've chosen for this little handout as a sort of a snippet of what's out there and what's in Langston Hughes's correspondence. But as a very kind of concluding remark, I wanted to read out the very last part of the last letter from 1955, last on the handout, when Langston Hughes is talking about receiving Valia's translations that appeared in Světová literatura. And he's saying, thank you so much for sending me your translation of the Weary Blues. The only problem now is to find someone in New York who can read it to me, since unfortunately I do not number any Czechs among my acquaintances, but I'm sure I shall find somebody. And I can tell from the manuscript that it seems to rhyme beautifully. So I thought that pointed out the paradoxes of translation and sometimes the impossibility of translation and understanding quite well. Okay, I have so many questions for our panelists, but something that came up again and again was this idea of multilingual poetics. And I wanted to start with asking you all whether you think that this, so we said, you know, Blatný was somebody who employed this in his later poetry, but probably also in his earlier poetry. A lot of scholarship has been done on Hughes and the way Hughes, who also translated himself, not from Czech, obviously, but also from Spanish, a bit from French as well, and other languages when he could. So we know that he's employed this multilingual poetics as well, and he draw inspiration from this in his own poetry. So we know that about Ludney and Hughes. So I'm wondering, is this something that's kind of inherently there, or is it a scale? Some people have it to a larger amount, some people not so much. Is it yes or no? How do you see this issue of multilingualism in poetry in more general terms?
Can I start? Okay, thank you very much for your thought-provoking comments, all three of you. And I also have questions for you, but I'll save them for later. Like Justin, I was surprised by Blatný's later poems in Stará bydliště, Pomocná škola Bixley, because I had seen macaronic poems from the 18th century, but I hadn't seen anything like it in modern poetry. So I focused on that as a very special phenomenon when I wrote my article about multilingualism in Blatný's poems. And Justin, you used wrestling with the python as a metaphor for translating Blatný's poems. And Blatný has this wonderful line in Pomocná škola Bixley, Python má až tři jazyky. And it comes as a declaration, an affirmation of the wonders of language. So that's a positive image of a python. But as I've continued studying multilingualism in literature, I've come to see all literature as multilingual, in a sense, or potentially so. And Blatný's life circumstances, perhaps, if we see it as a spectrum, his exposure to English led to the development in that direction of more explicit wordplay, as we see in this line, tři jazyky. Music was also very important for Blatný, and I suspect that for him, multilingualism and music in poetry were connected. And this translation that I see you have with you of Hughes' blues poems into Czech, I think, was perhaps pivotal for Blatný early in his writing career, in the same way as emigration to England was pivotal in leading to these explicitly multilingual poems, where he not only used English and Czech, but a number of other languages, German, even Esperanto, in a very playful way. I don't know if that answered your question. Let me pass the microphone.
I mean, like you, Julie, I see like a lot of literature, especially poetry, as multilingual. Maybe it isn't always as obvious as it is in, say, the late poems of Ivan Blatný, where, you know, like it switches languages sometimes midline, but sometimes it's present in the poet's biography and there's almost a deliberate suppression of another language. You have the Czech-American poet Jana Prikral, who grew up to the age of 8 in Ostrava and now writes in English, she lived in Canada, etc. And there are little kind of flickers of Czech realia, but also Czech language come through. When she mentions her mother, she refers to her as mama. I mean, she was raised in Czech by parents. And so you see like a very tenuous relationship there with another language, but nevertheless, in a poet who, like all American critics, consider to be writing like American poetry. So I think that there are, like, I would agree that there's a kind of spectrum, and it's as various as there are numbers of different poets and different writers. And I think that, you know, our job as critics who are kind of between several languages is to kind of keep our antennae up and to see what is going on at precisely such moments. Some writers want to suppress all trace of it, and that makes like our job as interpreters or as critics of poetry a bit more difficult, because you know, what's the evidence you have to go on? In terms of Blatney himself, I see it quite interestingly as at the beginning of his career, the poems of Brněnské elegie are written about a city that is a bilingual city, like Czech and German, very strongly both languages are there, but yet it is a very monolingual collection. It reports overhearing music, like the sound of songs is a thing. The sounds of the city are very important, and they're reported on regularly in the poems. But what happens with Tento Večer is something else. It is though he's letting the sounds of the city of Brno into his poems in an unprecedented way. You get overheard conversations in bad areas of the city. You get the, you know, brothels mentioned, urinals mentioned, all that sort of thing. And so he's deliberately trying to open the poems more to these kind of like acoustic particles of the city, the bits that are overlooked. And perhaps most importantly, from the point of view of his later career, he's letting in the different languages of the city. Like, for instance, it's not just German, but it's also, as Julie pointed out in her article, you know, like he says, he uses the word mami in, it's Basen Bitsizin Bitya, isn't it? Yeah. So like he doesn't translate it into mama or maminka or mati or something like that, but he uses the African-American way of calling it the mammy. Like in Irish English, we say the mammy, and it's not African, we're not quoting African Americans, but the mammy is like, it's from African American usage, Southern usage. And so he drops that into the poem as a marker of, you know, a foreign language that is also circulating in the city in this book. He overhears Hungarian soldiers talking, and he thinks about the kind of echo the language makes, this makes in the urban texture around them. And he's there waiting with his pen to kind of write down what this does to the urban space that he's in. So I think this is really important. As I said, given the fact that he then later on will just fully embrace macaronic poetry. And it's like, I see Tento Večer as almost like a testing ground for this like fluent movement between languages that becomes so central to his poetic later on. So.
Yeah, I don't know if I have a specific comment on that, but I love your last quote here from the archive, that he actually got the Czech translation of the Weary Blues and responds to that, and at least he can sort of read through it and see the rhymes. And I really like these like direct contacts that people have across these languages. But that brings it to like the blues, which is the part that of our sort of triumvirate we didn't quite touch on as much. But with Hughes, his work is a translation, like a transgenre, of translating blues into textual form. I mean, that's really his greatest contribution to American poetry generally, and the way that it reflected back into Czech poetry through Blatný is really interesting. So I'll just let us go on to the next set of questions.
Julie, do you want to comment? Because,
Mm-hmm. No, you're right that the Weary Blues are an intermedial translation from music to poetry. And then Blatný, even though he was to later find himself living in an Anglophone world, first read Hughes in Czech translation. And then he, inspired by Hughes' blues poems, then in a way translated, not directly, but translated that form into Czech in his own poems. So translation is central. Also, the concept of self-translation would be interesting to apply to Blatný, which is not something I've done yet, but self-translation as a phenomenon is getting more scholarly attention now, being the term for an author, when an author translates his or her own work. So it can be the process, but also the product. You can have a self-translated text. And only recently has this become a object of study in its own right in the West, whereas the concept was formulated by Ukrainian scholars of translation already in the 1920s. So in that way, the West has caught up to that. And self-translation is also sometimes used in a metaphorical way as well in the scholarship for translating more than the words on the page, but moving transculturally and transnationally when authors themselves, the writing subject, moves between different worlds.
Thank you. I will now pass around two objects, artifacts that I wanted to pass around earlier and forgot. But then I have one question specifically for Charles and then one for everybody. And then I thought we could open up the floor to, so you have an ample time to think about your own questions. Better to warn you before, because then there's always this awkward silence. Anyway, what I wanted to pass around before was something that's referred to in the correspondence, and that is this collection of poetry from poets from different African countries called Sluneční prudké pochodně, and you might have not seen it before because it was not distributed publicly. It was a New Year's gift of the Mladá Fronta Publishing House, prepared by Jiří Valia and Petr Kopta, mainly based on Hughes' recommendations. And then one issue of the magazine kind of focusing on world literature and translation, Pluff, that was about the kind of what Charles talked about, and Charles also quoted in here, the connections between Czechoslovakia and the Harlem Renaissance, and it also has Alain Locke essay that you were quoting, so a Czech translation of that. So I will just start there, and you can later.
In the meantime, I just want a small note. Like I loved the rhyme that he put together of Czechoslovak and black.
Yeah,
I mean for a rhyming poet, the words you choose to rhyme are often like really resonant, and you make deliberate choices of the things because you're creating. Not just like an acoustic identity, but you're implying also other identities.
I was actually thinking when I was going to read it aloud, I should use the because in American pronunciation, at least in the past, Slovak was quite common,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
But I decided to
be a little more standard. But that was what he would have in his mind, was Czechoslovak. Right, and it would rhyme actually. So.
And this is a perfect, actually, thank you for this, because this is a perfect introduction to my question to Charles. And that is, in some of the things that you have quoted, but also in the things you haven't quoted here, but elsewhere, we see this sort of a symbolic identification of Czechoslovakia and Czechoslovaks and African Americans. And I'm always very suspicious about that. And I think it's a very important of like, who is saying that? Who is making that parallel of Czechoslovak or the African Americans of Europe? And one has to be very, again, very careful with that. But it has been used in different historical contexts. It has been used even kind of unintentionally by Hughes, where he talks about the foreign and perhaps even like non-white or non-white groups that he sees around him in Cleveland. So I was just really curious what you thought about that, because this is one of the questions that we kind of have to deal with.
Well, that really comes to the question of ethnicity, which all of my material almost everything I have is from an article that I wrote called "A Long Way from Prague: The Harlem Renaissance in Czechoslovakia," which came out in the Journal of the Midwest Modern Language Association (MLA) about 5 years ago, and that was an issue specifically on, I think it was called inter-ethnicity, basically using the term ethnicity. And this is, it sort of shows how ethnic has shifted to become sort of a euphemism for race. And when you talk about ethnic studies today in the US, it really means, you know, African-American, Asian-American, Latino or Latinx, or, you know. But in the time we're discussing with Hughes, ethnicity really meant the, you know, other European groups. It was not the same as race, right? It was sort of within white, but sort of marginal. And that's really how ethnicity has shifted. So that's why I also find this interesting, that how it falls under definitions of ethnicity. And there's, of course, other even other African American writers who have looked at the connection. W.E.B. Du Bois, perhaps being the most prominent. And he actually got an honorary doctorate from Charles University, and he came several times to Czechoslovakia. Even before 1918, he was traveling in the Habsburg Empire, right? So there's all these other connections. But yes, it's interesting where, you know, obviously a lot of this is tied in with shifting political allegiances. Like Hughes, for example, he was very sort of socialist oriented, maybe not outright communist at the time, but he definitely leftist and then moved away from that with the McCarthy period in the US, whereas Du Bois got more and more radically leftist later on. So yeah, I think there's so much to look at with why they're making these points. But again, I'm interested in really these little passing direct references, like, and why they're making those, and why somebody like Locke, who was not really leftist in a very, you know, in any kind of politically engaged sense, other than, you know, generally looking for cultural uplift of the new Negro, of African Americans in Harlem, that why he would make that kind of a statement. And then somebody like Du Bois, from a totally different political standpoint, making somewhat similar statements. So yeah, I don't have an answer, but I think that's a really good thing to consider. So,
can I just come?
I'm glad you mentioned Du Bois, because I recently, apart from his 1958 visit that you also mentioned when he got the honorary doctorate from Charles University, I recently discovered a sort of a love story between Du Bois's granddaughter and a Czech, young Czech man, and the two of them met at kind of a youth congress at the end of the 1940s, when Du Bois was still able to travel to, you know, the world behind the Iron Curtain, because later on his passport was taken away. But what follows is a fascinating correspondence between this young man, who did not speak English at all, so somebody had to translate for him. He would write to his beloved, but also to Du Bois, asking for permission. And Du Bois is kind of like, yes, but you are 17 and you are 19. The Iron Curtain is there, traveling between the US and Czechoslovakia, you know, expensive. So he's like, yes, but also maybe not. And spoiler, this love story did not have any ending. I wasn't able to find out what happened with the Czech young man afterwards, but she got married to somebody else in the US, and so just waiting for somebody to, you know, make this into a movie. But until that happens, I'm gonna try finding ways to incorporate that into my own research. But love and you know, scholarly papers don't always mix. I guess my question, question before I open the floor to everybody. One of the many questions that I have, and that the one that I will choose right now, is so we know, and for the last 15, 20, 25 years, this transnational concept discourse is out there. We kind of absorb, we know that we are not looking only at these, as Jahan Ramazani says it really well, this like dynastic narratives of poet A begotting poet B, so we know that, and we are trying to approach text from this perspective, but also we have to deal with a structure that's built very much on a national based institutions that are aimed at national literatures and are part of this like national nation building process, funding that's also distributed in a certain way. So I was wondering how do we do it, or how do you do it, if you deal with these topics that are obviously and apparently very transnational, and that kind of move between cultures, how or can we approach these topics in today's world?
Shall I begin?
Please.
I really liked what you said, Franciszka, about influences never being a one-way street and not even a two-way street, that it's multi-directional. And I think, well, there are pragmatic reasons for, at certain historical times and places, for emphasizing the national, especially for countries with smaller populations. But literature is never as monolingual as it has seemed to us, you know, since the mid-19th century, and it's looking more and more multilingual, I think, today. And this is something that readers are becoming more interested in, publishers are becoming more tolerant of, and writers are responding to, I think, by being more openly multilingual. And as soon as you scratch the surface of any national literature, you discover multilingualism. If I compare the Swedish context, I was asked to write an encyclopedia article for a Routledge handbook on Nordic multilingual literature, which was a challenge for me. But what I discovered through that process was that the Nordic literatures also have always been more multilingual than it appeared. We just didn't see it because we weren't looking for it. And Charles and I had a discussion in the subway yesterday evening, soon after we had both arrived in Prague, and we realized so much of Czech and also Slovak literature, which Charles studies, is multilingual. We quickly came up with several examples of multilingual texts, including Blatný, of course. But you have to look for something in order to find it. And now we have a new set of lenses today that we didn't have just 20 years ago.
That's an optimistic answer. I hope that.
Well, I remain optimistic on this one as well. I think it's really interesting. to start off just with the lines in English in Blatney's text. Blatney is considered a Czech poet, but why? Like, why is he a Czech poet? Like, is he an English poet? He's equally just an English poet. Like, but, well, this language, yes. Okay, yes, he was born in Moravia. Maybe he's a Moravian poet. Maybe he's a Brno poet. But to take seriously the challenge of the English passages in Blatney's poems raises massive methodological questions for Czech literary historiography, which I feel that it's only beginning to be answered now. Because can Czech literature be in other languages? Well, the answer is yes. And there's just no doubt about it. But then what do you do about it? Who are they? What do you do about it? One person doing research on Václav Kilar at the moment, he's doing research on Czech Anglophone literature. So he's taking important writers who are Czech but write in English. Who are they? I mean, that's the thing. Like, a lot of them are unheard of now because they have been marginalized by nationalist narratives of literature, which presumes that Czech literature must be in Czech. And I think that, you know, work like that and work that's coming, like, in relation to other languages, and, like, my colleague Josef Erlicka could tell me more about these than I know about, and that's where I see, that's why I remain optimistic on that. The one I keep banging on about to everyone I meet, I say, go and read Edith Templeton. And they say, who? Czech literary scholars say who? English literary scholars say who? And I say, look, just do it. And everything will be clear. She was originally, I don't know, has anybody heard of her, actually? No, we're going, general no here. Yeah, you have. Did you read her, Josef?
No.
You see, I told Josef as well about 2 years ago, and he still hasn't read. That's what I'm up against. So Edith Templeton was born Edita Baserová. She came from a very rich landowning family in Jirny, and they owned like half of the land, the east of Prague. And she wrote novels in English that were mainly set during the First Republic, and she wrote them in the 1950s. She was quite well known in her time. She published in all the best places. Anita Bruckner, the fantastic novelist, tried to start her reputation going again in the 80s, but failed. And these are works at the highest level of European literature. And they, you know, they bear comparison with Joseph Roth in German, with Ivan Turgenev in Russian, and yet they are ignored completely. No one has heard of them. So the work is there to support this type of literary historiography. And this is just one of several, like, really important writers. So the work is there. So I just think it's up to us to kind of just start banging on tables. I'm banging on a table there.
I don't really have anything to add to what my colleagues have said so eloquently, but I don't, if we have questions, maybe if we're, our time is running low, we might hand it over to any other question.
I have a very pedestrian question. Is there a, let's say, linguistically satisfactory definition of multilingual literature? So if an author writes six lines or two words in some language other than the main body of the text, is he multilingual? Or if an author one day writes a short story in that language and next day in another language, is that multilingual? Or are we talking about multilingual readers? That's maybe the elephant in the room, because monolingualism has very often very kind of pragmatic reasons, namely monolingual market, readers market. So what is the, you know that I'm a linguist, so I'm interested in knowing what is really multilingual in that sense. I would say, for instance, that if you write six words in a poem in English, you are not multilingual. You are just dropping some words you know from somewhere, but it's not your standard practice unless you make it a fundamental statement or something like that. So there are many options. So that's.
I don't know who would. Yeah, I mean, if that's okay.
That's really,
yeah,
thank you.
So I can start at least, because this is a Python that I have wrestled with for some time. I've just completed a monograph called Reading Translingually, and The earliest definitions of literary multilingualism, the one most quoted is from the year 2000 by Stephen G. Kelman, who defines he uses the term translingualism as works written by authors writing in a non-native language. But that locates multilingualism with the author. And so I tried to develop a definition by studying texts, studying the functions of literary multilingualism in texts, and also degrees, how much of the text is in one language and then another. But then you raise the question comes up of how do we count languages as a translation, Japanese translation scholar whose name escapes me at the moment poses it. Also, the use of dialects within the same language can be seen as multilingualism. So I finally came, and as you put it, it's in the eye of the reader, at least to a certain extent, what the reader does with the text. And so the title of my monograph is actually Reading Translingually. I define it as a mode of reading, because readers do very different things with different languages in the same text. They may completely skip over words. It could be in your native language that you skip words that you don't understand, or you may focus on them particularly, and a sensitivity to multilingualism in a reading leads to different interpretations. I don't know if that was a good answer, but I'll stop there.
Yeah, I have nothing to say.
Yeah, I just think there are degrees, but obviously we have these, high Nabokov and these, unreachable examples, but I think probably being able to move between languages is sort of the definition, not just throwing in a few words that anybody can sort of cite things. But again, there's a lot of leeway in there. So,
but just a quick comment to that: we need to, I think, revise our view of Nabokov as an ideal bilingual writer. He was actually more than bilingual because he also wrote just a little bit in French, and if he had stayed in France, perhaps he would have become a French writer. But his, and it's archival research that has shown, by Olga Voronina in particular, that Nabokov's texts, less so later as he lived more years in the United States, but his early texts in English were heavily edited. He had language support, you could say. So I think maybe we also need to revise some of our preconceived notions and the stories we've been told. Conrad, Nabokov, even Brodsky, they're sort of the examples, and they're viewed as exceptions, as, you know, unique exceptions to the monolingual rule. Whereas I prefer to look for multilingualism in different forms. And I think multilingualism also allows for imperfection in language, allows for non-standard language.
Yes.
Just briefly, that one of the massive consequences of your question as well is, you know, how do we deal with this institutionally? Because we have, you know, built departments like series, book series that are, you know, around the idea of like nation language. And when you come along and say, well, you know, like say Czech literature can be in other languages, Irish literature can be in German, etc., like this. So like, what are all these places just going to go away in a burst, you know, puff of logic? They can't. But I think that really the conversation too long has been going on in certain European literatures that, you know, that restrict a nation's literature to one language. And I think that even though there will be profound institutional consequences to this, that the conversation has to begin. Even just for the benefit of readerly pleasure, there are great writers out there who are just not circulating and who are a pleasure to read. And I think that, and really illuminate the multilingual nature of the world we live in now. And there's an archive of these writers, and it's not just something that has been, you know, come into existence with globalization and the fall of the Iron Curtain, etc. This goes back a long, long way before Herder. So I think just it's really difficult to say, you know, there's like a whole range there. As I said earlier, the answers to whether a writer is multilingual is as various as there are writers. That like some, yeah, a little bit, others might just throw one word in English, but that is part of a larger imaginative engagement with the literature of another language. So
just to comment on the readership, that was also part of the question. Sorry, Charles, did you want to? I will give Ola the microphone in a minute. Just quoting Justin this time, Justin, in your essay on Jan Zabran, a Czech poet that you have also translated, you say that in a certain sense, an ideal reader for Zabrana's poetry is Zabrana himself, right? Somebody who, knows English, knows the Anglophone poetic tradition, also knows the Russian poetic tradition, is able to kind of work out the different references and the kind of snippets of different poems. And I just think it further complicates the question of who can read, but we can still read Zabrana with great pleasure, despite not having that background that he had. So I just wanted to bring that up. And then,
thank you. I'm sorry, I wanted to pick up on this issue of multilingual literature. I'm sorry. Because I was wondering, why is it a category? Because, okay, recently I've come across the term plurilingualism, that this is like, that it's more used in French studies maybe, but that but some English like scholars also apply the term plurilingualism to point to this competence of using a lot of languages, or like is it a lot of languages actually? This is my interest is a lot in border studies and how it, you know, like manifests itself in literature and in language as well. So I mean, why is multilingualism a category when we talk about literature? Because it seems that, like, I know that up until some time ago, languages were treated like separate, like there was a national language which was treated as a separate entity. But like, I guess right now, even in Scandinavian universities, I guess in Norway, there's research, supposedly it's something so totally new, a new perspective on researching links between learning a lot of languages, also like, you know, those that you have at school, like maybe twice a week only, and that they treat it as one entity, that it's all like, you know, kind of, it forms one language in your brain. So my question is like maybe comment slash question about that, you know, like why do we insist on, or why do scholars insist on a category of multilingual literature if it's just, you know, like one language in a way? And like Rosie Braidotti, I guess, wrote in Nomadic Subjects that most populations are not monolingual. Yeah, so I mean, why are we discussing this? I'm sorry. Thank you.
So thank you so very much for organizing this. I would like to, if I may, jump in with my questions and comments that partly answer yours. Actually, if I may, the answer would be the structures of power. Coming from Poland, working in France, I've got at least two reasons to insist on this aspect. On the one hand, what's happening politically in Poland is a great example, because the question that you raised a while ago, why do we finally start to work and who will finance this? In a country in which 30 million zlotys are now given to national programs of exposing the... And this is not only... So just to give you an example from this point of view, but on another example would be Francophony. The French cope since decades on how to deal with this very post-colonial, neo-colonial invention. Also in scholarship, trying to, maybe the greatest problem to see French literature and French language literature as French, as world literature, is Francophony as a notion, because it ranges in falls, but the center is very precise in very one place, in even very one district of the world, very one city. But anyway, I was so happy to listen to you. And just I wanted to put like two or three categories on the table, because I've been myself working on similar questions, both in Czech literature, in Central European literature, and in French. You've been speaking about influences and languages going in different senses. Helga Mitterbauer and Carrie Smith Braid work since a few years on the notion of transcultural, that's supposed to use to cultural transfers combined with rhizomatic multidimensionality and directionality, and this would be actually maybe a one tiny element. I was thinking also of listening to you for Yasmin Yildiz and the post-monolingual condition, obviously, because those are the elements that appear. And the third notion, maybe of the one used by Xavier Gelmisch, some of you know, since his PhD in the late 80s, of polyglossis, of functionalizing the languages. I've been myself working on a guy called Ladislav Klima, you may know, that has written his diaries here in this very city in up to six languages, 40% of Czech, German, 10% Macaronic French, Macaronic Latin, and some Greek notions. And maybe a question to finish this enthusiastic remarks, as you can see, is that Kundera once wrote in his preface to Chvatik's anthology of Czech poetry in the late 80s that we suffer from the Yalta der Universitäten, the Yalta of universities, speaking of the separation of Central European cultures towards the West. But is it that starting from here, the separation in national departments and philological traditions blocks actually, or blocked for quite a long time, seeing the multilingual nature of any literary creation? But we have in contrast, we do not have that much of a problem of looking at Neo-Latin literatures and Macaronic traditions before the building of modern nations, actually. The tradition of working out through Macaronism in Latin literatures and Central European literatures developed with no problem since quite a long time. And we only have problem with the recent 19th century, 20th century national traditions. It's a provocative modern, that would be my question to you.
Thank you so much, Ola Holubovic from the Faculty of Arts, and Matosz Morski, the director of CIFRES. I just wanted to contextualize before I pass on the microphone that we are also asking this question on the premises of the Institute of Czech Literature, which is the Institute of Czech Literature used to have a world literature department as well, doesn't anymore. So just bear in mind that context as well. I don't know who wants to.
Since you just mentioned that, it's interesting because in Slovakia, there still is a separation between the Ustav Slovenskej literatury and Ustav Svetovej literatury. They've kept that, which they closed in Prague, I guess, in the 90s. But they still have these two institutes, which are together but separately focused. So, and Slovakia is an interesting case for me, because Slovakia And again, it's always this sort of assumption that we look at the larger a society or a culture is, it's somehow more cosmopolitan and more multilingual, and the smaller ones are more. But again, just as with these connections between the smaller literatures or smaller sub-minority literatures, Slovak culture is still, you know, setting aside Hungarian, which most Slovaks don't have linguistic access to, but it's very bilingual. The Czech is everywhere in Bratislava, in Slovakia. You walk around Prague, I mean, I probably couldn't find a book in Slovak, I mean, except in the library here, but in a bookshop anywhere in the center of Prague, unless they're translated into Czech, right? So Slovaks read in Czech, Czechs don't read in Slovak, right? So again, there's all these different, in terms of multilingualism and power structures, obviously that's a huge part of it, so.
I just have a small point. Thank you so much for your remarks. Even within Anglophone literary studies, the situation is terrible. That I'm outside my Prague institution at the moment, the Charles University, the Filozofická fakulta, where English is taught on the basis, the two pillars of British and American literature, which reduces, like, nationalizes everything, and it creates a false tradition of, you know, leading from Beowulf to Shakespeare to blah 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 to Graham Greene, and it's like, and they, you know, they sprinkle a little magic dust of like post-colonialism at the end to make everything okay, but you just cannot get over the structural lie at the heart of it. And, you know, even Beowulf, like, Beowulf is great, etc., but it's put there after the fact. Beowulf became the foundation of English literature in the 19th century. Like, I mean, how does that work? How can it be a foundation if no one knew about it all that time? And like, but somehow it was magicked into foundation status. And the same goes for American literature. And, you know, when you consider that English is a global lingua franca, and it has been for many, many decades, but yet this is not reflected at all in this way. So, sorry, I just had to get that off my chest tonight. I'll calm down.
Thank you for your insightful questions and comments. And Yildiz's book, The Postmonolingual Condition, I would recommend, if you're seeking an explanation for why all of the talk about multilingualism now, that says more about us and European Western societies today than it does about the literature itself, which multilingualism is as old as any text. So it's nothing new, but it's something we have recently, and it started around the turn of the millennium, I think, started to catch sight of. And I think the fact that it's given a particular name, and there are many names for it. There's heterolingualism. There's a saying in Swedish that a favorite child has many names. And I think it's something that more and more scholars are becoming interested in. It's also a reaction, I think, to the Yalta agreement within academia that divides us up into categories that we're dependent on for promotion, for the way courses are taught, the way funding, research funding is distributed. And I think the world has changed. This is reflected in literature, so it's natural that scholars also will start to focus on this. One interdisciplinary field that I think has gone further in overcoming the borders of literary studies is translation studies. Because translation, you know, entails always movement between cultures and languages.
Thank you
would we have, I feel like we can go on for quite a while, but since we want to wrap it up to keep it short and brief and sweet, short and sweet, do we have any final questions? And I'm sure our speakers will be available after we finish to kind of talk to you. But do we have any questions from the audience at this point? No. There is a hilarious letter from one Slovak translator to Langston Hughes that I did not include because I felt like it would need a lot of contextualization. But that translator, who is not a translator, but somebody who wants to translate Hughes's poem, says, please, could you, you know, he starts off like Valia did, asking for explanation of specific African American references, but then he goes on and he pretty much wants everything explained because he says, well, I don't actually know US culture that well, and I don't actually even speak English as well. So Langston Hughes, could you please explain pretty much everything that's going on in your poetry? One of the reasons why I did not want to include it is because it seemed very anti-Slovak to include only this one Slovak reference there, but just to give you an anecdote to finish. If we don't have any questions, then let's finish the official part. And then again, we're here for an informal chat as well. And thank you so much again for coming. And it was great to see so many people from so many different angles of the issue. So thanks again.
Thank you.